Tonight, we will hear from two brave warriors, warriors who have changed the history of this nation. This is an exciting and historic moment. It reminds me of how far we have come and how far we still must go. In 1896, the United States Supreme Court, in Plessy versus Ferguson, said that separate but equal is constitutional. In other words, you can treat people separately based solely upon their skin color. That lasted until May 17, 1954, when a cadre of black lawyers under the leadership of Charles Hamilton Houston, who had died 4 years before but had taught them and had taught his favorite student, Thurgood Marshall, took on that decision in the United States Supreme Court. And of course, we know that Brown versus the Board of Education held that separate but equal is unconstitutional. 1954. 3 years later, September 1957, I was in Arkadelphia, Arkansas, but up the road was a capital, Little Rock, Arkansas, with this great big segregated school called Central High. But there was another thing going on. And Daisy Lee Bates and the NAACP had a different vision for Little Rock and Central High. And as a result of that, 9 brave young black children stepped up, courageous, to say, yes, we will go, we will integrate Central High. And when they appeared at the door of Central High, there was an angry white mob there. And the governor of Arkansas, Farwas at that time, had brought in the National Guard, 10,000 strong, to prevent these little students, these 9 students, from going into that school. But there was a greater day coming. Martin Luther King Jr. wrote to President Eisenhower and said, this is a moment for you. And about 3 weeks later, Eisenhower sent the 101st Born, 81st Born Division of the U.S. Army to Little Rock. He did one other thing to make certain it went right. He federalized, nationalized the Arkansas National Guard. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight is a special night. Is it a night because we get to see in person and get to hear in person two of those voices that stood against great odds and were able to survive.
I believe that the lecture series embodies this quote. Do what is right, not what is easy. This is something that I see over and over from the various speakers that come and are presented to us, because we hear about the struggles that it takes to make things right. And it seems that it is an ongoing issue. So keep in mind, it was not easy for Ms. Brown and Dr. Roberts to decide to join her fellow classmates and his fellow classmates in Little Rock Central High School. It was not easy for their families, let alone their parents, to see the verbal and the physical assaults that they experienced. It was not easy to be part of the needed social change and hold back the tears. This evening, we are going to be reminded on how our youth become our future leaders and heroes of tomorrow. We can affirm that doing the right thing takes enormous amount of courage, strength, and a great sense of social responsibility. I know that many of you in this audience this evening, especially our youth, have those elements in mind, but many times are asking yourselves, is this the right time? When will I have all the skills, all the knowledge, all the talent that I need to step up? Again, I'm going to remind you, because all of us had to take that step, that risk, as you heard our speaker, when he chose to go to Merritt College, when some of his friends chose not to continue, he did. We all have a similar story like this, and I truly believe that we need to continue to encourage our youth. Education is the pathway for options and for choice. So I'm going to leave you with this. Martin Luther King said many, many years ago, the time is always right to do the right thing.
Good evening, friends. Thank you, everyone, for coming out this evening. We want to especially thank Ms. Minnie Jean Brown-Tricky and Dr. Terrence Roberts for accepting our invitation to be part of the Barbara Lee and Elihu Harris Lecture Series. You know, anger is the enemy of family and community, and pride is a monster that swallows us up. Think of the most instigating person. See them right in front of you. You can clench a mighty fist, but then what do? If you want that person to help create community, you must act with nonviolence. Give that person respect. Separate their action from their personhood. If you want that person to be helped with the renewal of the mind, then you smile at that person. If you believe that this person can develop self-management, then you give them goodwill. Whenever you are hurt, mentally, physically, emotionally, always work to forgive, because forgiveness allows the chance for bonding and connection between you and that other person. Dr. King says that forgiving does not mean forgetting. Acts of violence against another increase injustice. And Dr. King was a great, patient, and loving man. And he has taught people like us to love the self, to love others. And that love is like the sunshine you receive every time you wake up in the morning. Nonviolence is made up of three elements. First, justice makes a devotion to the truth. Do not let anger overcome and ruin your message. Second, peace commits to the constant renewal of the mind. That means that you accept that you don't know everything and that you commit to constantly learning and constantly being curious. Lastly, respect is committed to the development of self-control. Control your anger, vengeance, thoughts of violence, and do not clench a fist at your brother or sister, but instead hold their hand. If we follow these components, then we develop hope, we develop faith and change, and we create the power to heal and make the world a better place. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Angela Drake. I'm 13 years old, and I am a team member of the Freedom Center Youth Leaders. All of us at the Freedom Center want to thank Merritt College, and especially President Ambris Galavis, for all she does for us. I want to say a few words offering my viewpoints on today's moment in the movement of justice. We fight so hard for something that seems like it's being torn back down. The Little Rock Nine and many other generation have transformed segregated schools into integrated ones. Today, many go from segregated classes to the prison to school pipeline. We have gone from police forces blocking school doors to police stationed in every single school. We have arrived at a point where many are shot down before they even get to walk in school doors. We went through many single forms of slavery, from actual slavery to Jim Crow and to now mass incarceration of colored people. Just because something is redesigned doesn't mean it's gone. Fighting without organization won't stop these issues. Racial slurs won't stop these issues. Violence will not stop these issues. Because hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that. Without love, we are lost, hopeless, alone. Now is the time for togetherness, hope, unity. One person cannot do the work of a thousand. Every hand is needed in building this wall of hope. Brothers, sisters, we shall overcome. Thank you.
Can you imagine 1957? Teenager, only having attended a segregated school, now being called upon to enter the biggest school, largest school in Little Rock. Minnie Jane Brown has a lifelong experience and commitment to peacemaking, environmental issues, and developing youth leadership, just to name a few. She is an outstanding hero, shero. She's a legend. She's a person that has made it possible for many of us and many of our children to be where we are today. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Minnie Jean Brown Tricky.
Thank you so much. Thank you. What a beautiful audience. It's always my pleasure to look upon an audience such as this. I'm honored to be a part of this lecture series, and I have been hanging out with those amazing students in the Martin Luther King Freedom Center. And let me tell you, I have been energized, inspired, enriched, and we've had lots of food. It's been wonderful. I'm so pleased to be here. And also had this amazing opportunity to be with Terrence Roberts, somebody I've admired. We were in the sixth grade together, so that gives you an idea. It's very special for me, Terrence. When I was watching the footage, I didn't mean to feel emotional, but sometimes I do. Elizabeth Eckford is a girl whose picture is called one of the most important photographs in the 20th century. And she's the girl who was mobbed. And part of the story about Elizabeth is that she was going to school. So at some point, I discovered this poem. It's called Soul, Make a Path Through Shouting, for Elizabeth Eckford, Little Rock, Arkansas, 1957. It's by Cyrus Cassells. Thick at the school gate are the ones rage has twisted into minotaurs, harpies, relentlessly swift. So you must walk past the pinchers, the swaying horns, sister, sister, straight through the gusts of fear and fury, straight through. Where are you going? I'm just going to school. Here we go to meet the hydra-headed day. Here we go to meet the maelstrom. Can my voice be an angel on the spot, an amen corner? Can my voice take you there, gallant girl with a notebook, up, up from the shadows of gallows trees to the other shore? A globe bathed in light, a chalkboard blooming with equations. I've never seen the likes of you, pioneer in dark glasses. You won't show the mob your eyes, but I know your gaze, steady on the North Star burning. With their jerry-rigged faith, their spear of the American flag, how could they dare to believe you're someone sacred? Burr-headed girl, where are you going? I'm just going to school. So if we want to think about the complexities that emerged as the Little Rock desegregation crisis, you have to understand that on the day that we put our names on a list, we were planning to go to school. We had no idea of what was to come, because in some ways it was the first. And we've been asked, what preparation did you have? Well, what kind of preparation do you get for something that hasn't happened before? You just go to school and let the rest be history, I guess, as we can say. As a social worker, I have, yes. My actions have found me walking side by side with the least among us, Inuit and indigenous peoples in different parts of the world, youth, the incarcerated, the homeless, immigrant and refugee women, rich or poor, school children of every color, those with disabilities, victims of violence, and the list goes on. They are my friends, my neighbors, those I work with, even my family. This is not a list to glorify myself, but a set of descriptions to indicate my range of experience and contact. Based on what I have come to know, I believe unequivocally that those considered least among us tell us who we are, what our real values are. They are our mirror image. We may describe some as vulnerable, but their vulnerability is ours as well. I translate that to mean, if others are not free, then I'm not free. And the moment we come to that understanding, then it changes, it transforms us, it gives us meaning for life, it energizes. So much of what is going on today, everybody says, oh, racism is, did somebody say covert? And I didn't say anything, but I almost said, are you out of your ever-loving mind? But I was cool. And it turned out that a young woman said, no, it's not. I'm afraid every day. A young black woman said, I'm afraid every day. That's not covert. That's real. And I was moved by her because it was in a university setting. Those are the kinds of conversations that should be happening every day in universities. But I think somebody's got to start it. And when someone says that racism is now covert, I don't want some child to have to cry to help somebody understand that it's not covert. We need to have these authentic, hard conversations. And it boggles my mind that in 2015, we still haven't had them. And when we were with the young people, which was just, you guys, you young people, thank you. You know, I can go to the next struggle with a certain amount of enthusiasm and hope because of you. And I'm going to tell you a secret, people. I don't bother with old people. I just... Honestly, somebody once said that when you're talking to young people, they want to learn. When you're talking to older people, you're trying to change their minds. I don't waste my time trying to... It's just, the younger I can get them, the better it is, right? So one of the things we were talking about in our discussions, you asked wonderful questions, was about talking to people, speaking to people, reaching out and touching, actually. Dr. King says it's nonviolence or non-existence. That's pretty clear. If we look in this place, this day, wherever we live, we know that violence is destroying the fabric of every aspect of our lives. So isn't it great that we have young people speaking out against violence? Please understand, this is hard work. Let me tell you, it's a life sentence. I've told my kids, put rhinestones on my walker or whatever has to happen, because I know that I will be doing this the rest of my life. There's a book called Talking to Strangers. The author tells us that one of the first lessons we teach our children is don't talk to strangers. And she says, democracy requires vulnerability before one's fellow citizens. How can we talk to each other when we insist on using such words such as different, stranger, alien? Alien, what are you talking about? When I was a kid, that was a space creature. And that's part of our, what we say, the things we say about other people. All those terms sound like other, not me, not the same as me. I hate the word different, because I'm brainwashed equally. In this country, if you watched Leave It to Beaver when you're a kid, you were, and you read Fun with Dick and Jane. I know only a few of you know about that. But that was serious brainwashing, okay? And some people started to believe that a television show was real. I was looking at those signs that those people had out in front of Central High School, and I can tell you, next week I can go to a rally and I can see exactly the same signs. Now, isn't that profound intentional ignorance? Profound intentional laziness? They went to their basement and got those same old signs. I'm serious. Do you know what I mean? And I was in a session, and I was really surprised. And I'm just The way I do this is just kind of talk. I did an exercise, and I talked to you young people, and the diabolical intention that I have with that exercise is to get people to claim ethnicity. And when it's over and I'm in a room with 1,000 people, when I get a debrief, the only people who claim ethnicity are people of color. So I asked the group, how is this possible? And this woman said, I don't have to claim ethnicity. I'm the norm. I was so glad. I mean, blood was dripping down my... But I didn't say anything. Because I like for people to say stuff like that in public. So when we... Then people can say they want to take their country back. So I said to her, well, blacks came to the shores of the America in 1615. When do I get to be normal? Take your country back. Let me tell you, my folks built it. You can't have it back. You stole it from the indigenous folks, then you don't want to give me any credit for building it? It ain't working like that. But I'm going to kind of keep with the theme of nonviolence and read another poem, because I find poems soothe me. And it's by Thich Nhat Hanh, and he wasn't at Central, but he might as well have been there. His poem says, I hold my face in my two hands. No, I'm not crying. I hold my face in my two hands to keep the loneliness warm. Two hands protecting, two hands nourishing, two hands preventing my soul from leaving me in anger. So that, to me, describes our survival technique at Central. And I can't speak for Terrence. I want to say to you, especially young people, our going to Central was not courageous. The first principle of nonviolence says, nonviolence is a way of life for courageous people. And a teacher said, well, I don't understand that. I said, well, based on going to Central, we went there and the courage came later. So that is the way that I explain that. The third principle, and that's what we're playing. We're playing nonviolence here. This is very important stuff. Nonviolence holds that suffering can educate and transform. Because of that experience in Little Rock, I've spent my life trying to comprehend exactly what happened, to learn what made people be the way they were. And Little Rock is a morality play for me. It has mob violence, that choice. It has 20 nice kids at Central, 100 bad kids at Central, 1,900 who were silent witnesses, the Elie Wiesel concept. Then it had the Little Rock Nine. And Terrence today was talking to the young people about choice. And in that morality play that is the Little Rock desegregation crisis, one can choose which we can be in that situation in life, in our relationships with each other at every level. We can be the bad kids, the good kids, the mean girls, the mob. The silent witnesses, Or we can be the persistence of the human spirit. And that's how I identify the Little Rock Nine. Thank you very much.
At age 15, a young black boy leaving a school where he was very, very comfortable and doing quite well in his segregated classes. Terrence J. Roberts, now Dr. Roberts, entered those classes with his mind made up, ain't no stopping me now. He was determined. Ladies and gentlemen, a man of courage, a man among men, a man who has not only stood and looked fear in its face, but a man who said that no matter what you do, no matter how loud you may yell at me, you're not gonna stop me. Dr. Terrence Roberts.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all the sponsors who were responsible for making it possible for all of us to be here, for the program organizers. You know, it's like coming back home when I get to this area because I spent a significant portion of my adult life up in the Napa Valley. But the only place where I could really spend money was down here in the Bay Area. In fact, things got so bad with my family, my wife and daughters, frequenting San Francisco, that every time I would go into Macy's by myself, I would hear salesmen calling out, Dr. Roberts, how are you? And I'd never met these people. They only knew me by credit card. But there's something else that's important about tonight, and that is being around people, all of the program organizers and those of you in the audience, who, by virtue of your presence here, indicate that you too have joined the Army for Social Justice. And being around you is hard to describe with words, but there's something in the air that I could feel at the bone marrow level. That's a good feeling, because it doesn't happen often. I'm grateful as well that I get to share a platform with Minnie Jean Brown Trickey. You know, it's always a true delight to have the two of us together. We, Minnie and I, have walked through more than one valley of the shadow of death. And it's good to be back in Northern California for another reason, because this is a place where I actually started my first clinical practice, a few miles north of where we are today. I was up in Angwin, California, a little burg just up the hill from St. Helena. And I had a position at that time on the faculty at Pacific Union College. And I'll never forget, I said to a colleague, I'm going to open a psychological clinical practice. And he looked at me with sort of a frown and a rather dubious look. And he said something that seemed to be one of the most crazy non sequiturs I'd ever heard. He said, but it's a long way to Vallejo. Well, at that time, I couldn't put it all together. I figured it out, though. A few weeks later, somebody told me Vallejo was where a large number of black people lived. Now, what this told me, this colleague of mine had assumed that if I were to open a clinical practice, it would, by definition, have to be in Vallejo. In his mind, I was not the kind of person who could have a clinical practice in that area of California. He was unable to see me as a peer. He saw me, as he saw all black people, I concluded, as creatures of myth, mythological, not really human. We, in his eyes, didn't merit the status of real human beings, but we could only exist as a composite of all of these stereotypical notions. A shadow of that pernicious way of thinking had actually fallen across my path many years ago. In fact, on the very day of my birth. Now, I wasn't aware of it at the time, but my mom helped out. My mom saved the evidence. Oh, yeah. She made certain that I knew what had happened. You see, in that first week in December of 1941, all of the babies born in Little Rock or near environs were listed in the local paper as having joined the universe. And so the list starts off, and all the parents are presented as Mr. and Mrs. with their progeny, gave the statistics about weight and length, etc. And they are presented with the social honorifics of Mr. and Mrs. That is, for those babies listed in the first group. Now there's a second group. And the second group is where I am, but the parents are not presented as Mr. and Mrs. And when you look at that, you note right away, if you are aware of the social conditions in this country, what has happened. Now, if you're not, you might think there's been a printer's mistake, an error, and that tomorrow this will all be cleared up, that those titles will be placed. But no, all of the parents who did not merit the social title of Mr. and Mrs. were black parents. So when you get to my entry, you don't see Mr. and Mrs. Roberts, you see William and Margaret. First names only. You know, extrapolating from that, years later, I taught a class at university, and I had the students talk to me about the first time they were involved in an encounter with someone different from themselves, somebody racially different from themselves. 99% of my students were white. One girl said, well, I can't remember. I think it must have been when I got to college before I was able to interact with anybody of color. And she sat in the desk and looked puzzled as others were talking. Then all of a sudden, she had an epiphany. Her face lit up. Her hands went up, both of them. She says, pardon me, I have to make an amendment. I grew up with a black nanny. How did she miss that? Sometimes it happens that way. Sometimes. Well, there is no biological, or scientific basis for the concept of race, but it is one of the most prevalent mythological constructs around. There's something about it, though, that causes us a certain bit of schizophrenia. Ergo, my student who couldn't remember that she had been nurtured by this black woman. Well, the historical records tells us very true that the term race itself is very new to the human lexicon. It wasn't here all the time. You can go back in history and you can keep digging, and then you'll find somewhere around the mid-16th century the term was introduced. Now, my notion of how that happened perhaps is apocryphal, I don't know, but I'll accept it as truth anyway. It is reported that a group of pseudoscientists came up with the concept, and they created, in addition to that term itself, a hierarchy with whiteness to blackness, and then they sold that to us, the public, and we bought it without a whimper. And now, today, the concept is not only strong, it's getting stronger every day. It's getting stronger. Now, that's a problem, because that interferes with our ability to make sense out of the truth that is there. We can't see it. Our vision is clouded. And it does strange things to me. For the past few nights, I've actually been unable to sleep very well. I haven't had trouble sleeping for most of my life, but lately, I can only get 4 or 5 hours of sleep. I don't know quite what it is that signals that it's time for me to wake up. When I wake up, I don't see any sunshine coming through. It's still dark. So I reason that it's too early, and I look at the clock, and I'm reassured that it is too early. I woke up this morning in this hotel at 3:13 a.m. Well, what happens, and I know because I've checked it out, I've asked myself some questions, because when I wake up, I'm sweating and my heart is pounding and my pulse beat is, you know, just out there. And the images I see projected on the walls of my mind are pretty much surreal because they're mixed up. There's Walter Scott and there's Trayvon Martin and there's you know, Eric Garner, there's Michael Brown, and it all gets smooshed together. And then the really crazy thing is my grandsons show up. And they're just 12 and 9 as we speak. But the fear about their fate concerns me. It's that kind of craziness. This is my first encounter of the day, every day now. And it's only what the power of the prayer and supplications that you out there who are praying people offer that helped me to get through this. I know it. And I thank you because with your help, I'm able to go on to the second vision of the day. And that often includes having to deal with real dragons out there in the neighborhood. And it's not the myth of race alone that causes us trouble. There's so many strands of mythological stuff woven together. Black criminality, white supremacy, black inferiority, equality of opportunity, meritocracy, America as a Christian nation, equal justice under the law, the sanctity of the patriarchy, and a host of other ill-founded but very strong principles that people do believe in. We have a lot to deal with. A question that I hear often from people who occupy the political spectrum, especially on the far right, say this, why is it that so many black people are not taking advantage of all the opportunities available to them? And I sit there and think, this is not the right question. A much better, more nuanced question would be, why is it that so many black people succeed in spite of the barriers placed in their way? Well, and then there's this myth about space. You know, in this country, we've always had this real obsession with space and who owns it, who can occupy it, you know. As our MC was pointing out, with the 1896 decision, the Plessy decision, which declared that it was legal for us to separate ourselves based on racial group membership, it was about space. You know, the case itself, Plessy was not allowed to occupy the space that he could afford to pay for because he was allegedly a black person. Although, phenotypically, when you looked at Plessy, you couldn't tell. You were confused. They say he's black, but yeah, look at him. Well, this myth is applied to living space, workspace, recreational space, worship space. Historically, of course, it was upheld by law and by custom. Today, just by custom alone. Now, when we walk around the streets of Oakland, you won't see signs that say no niggers, no Jews, no dogs. You probably won't see those signs. But there are other ways that people have figured out these signs don't have to be up there. Let me give you an example of how this stuff might work. In 1998, my wife and I moved from the Napa Valley down to the city of Pasadena, California. And we decided to buy a home, so we hired a real estate agent to help us find a house. We had never lived in Pasadena. We were unfamiliar with that terrain, so we left it up to the agent, a young white woman who seemed very bubbly, very excited to be able to help us. Very friendly, and she took us to see house after house after house after house. We were house looking weary. But this went on for several weeks. By that time, we had gotten in the car and we began to tool around Pasadena and acquaint ourselves with the place, and we saw something that seemed odd. We were seeing all of these houses, but they were all in one area. So we thought, wow. So we fired her. We hired another agent, similar to the first one, same thing. Ah, so we said, here's a pattern. So we fired the second one and decided we're going to go out on our own. And so we did. We found time, we went around, we found a house, sign in the yard, for sale. Agent's name, telephone number. We called up, we made an appointment. Wednesday morning, 10 o'clock. We show up about 9:55. We see coming down the stairs of this two-story building a person with a clipboard, a smile on her face, as if she's anticipating a 10 o'clock appointment. She sees us. The smile fades. She grasps the clipboard to her chest, makes an abrupt U-turn, and runs up the steps. And this is quite a feat because she is wearing high-heeled shoes. I say to my wife, that's our 10 o'clock person. She says, are you sure? I says, yes, let's follow her. And so we do. We follow her to her office, and sure enough, we're on her list. She checks our ID to make sure. We show her ID to make sure. She sells us the house. Because now, because of the 1954 decision, the law is on our side. See, it's so important. See, the 1954 decision, a lot of people forget this. It's not only about education. That was the arena. But it had a wide embrace. And it means that for us, we now have protections that we didn't have before. We didn't have them for those centuries, multiple centuries, but by law, we do have them. Now, you may be saying, well, yeah, but what does that mean? And you're right, there's so much work to do. But we start with something solid like the law changing. We move into the house. The neighbor comes over as we are there with the moving van, and she is out of breath, and she says, I want you to know, I voted for you in the Neighborhood Watch Council meeting. Well, we thank her profusely because it sounds, you know, really genuine. And then we inquire, what was this vote about? She says, well, the neighbors got together to determine if they wanted to support your presence in the neighborhood. We squeaked by. We had just enough votes, as it turned out. But the fact that the vote was divided meant that life there was not the most pleasant experience. We hung in there for 10 years, then we gave it up. We moved to a much better neighborhood. Wow. You know, one thing that really keeps me going in the face of this onerous reality is the fact that I know there are other people in the world who see it the way I do. I am not alone. See, if I felt I were alone, I don't think I could handle it. I'd just keel over and die. But the fact that I know out there someplace, there's at least one or two other people who are fighting the same fight, and as many said, these young people here today, gives us renewed hope that there are a lot of people who know how to do this stuff. 10 years ago, I was invited to give a commencement address for the graduating seniors at Pacific Oaks College in Pasadena. And the talk that I gave was included in one of the essays that make up this book, Simple Not Easy, one of my books. And the fact that I put it in here and I'm bringing it out tonight is because it's relevant to what we're talking about tonight. I'll quote from page 14. We have become a society prone to cutting corners and rounding the edges of integrity in an effort to create acceptable rationales for the self-enhancing schemes that threaten to weaken, if not destroy, the foundational principles of this country. And in addition to that, I'd like to read a few words from pages 24 and 25. This was an interesting process in writing this book because I realized that I had a lot of essays just hanging around. Looked in my drawer and the files were bulging. I said to myself, I got a book hidden in here. I better pull it out. And so it happened. But at any rate, here we are on page 24. We have a national narrative, I call it, and that is the message that we give to school kids and other people. This tells them who we are as a nation and what we're supposed to do as individual citizens and so forth. Our national narrative is one that describes a utopian ideal, a goal for us to lean toward perhaps, but not yet realized. Too often, however, this grand rhetoric with no substance fills the airwaves. The media pages and the billboards constitutes the sound bites, flows freely from academic podiums, religious pulpits, and political stumps, and seeks to convince all of us that nirvana has indeed arrived. This manufactured text is presented as fact. Anybody can grow up to be president of these United States. All people are created equal. In this system of meritocracy, hard work and education will result in the bestowal of appropriate rewards. You could pull yourself up by your bootstraps if you really wanted to, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Noisy, ubiquitous, intrusive, and extremely seductive. This train of thought is often accompanied by built-in resistance to any other way of thinking or believing. Now, having been baptized in these same waters, I, too, was a firm believer at one time in the national narrative. As a young kid, upon hearing the gospel of manifest destiny, let me tell you, I was a ready convert. America for Americans, Christianize the heathen, root out the filthy commies, two cars in every garage, one wage-earning dad, one stay-at-home mom, two kids, one dog, and a picket fence, a white picket fence. It was a package deal, and I was told it was the best thing going. And fortunately, however, I learned how to read. And at some point, I learned to think. And then the whole fabric began to unravel. At first, I thought the narrative was simply incomplete, the sins of omission, and it was just a matter of filling in the blank spots. But that was not to be. Too many people believe in this rather specious comparison by saying that America, even though it has faults, is better than anything else in the universe. You've heard that? It's a poor argument, a very poor argument. But it was that kind of thinking that led to the circumstance of United States Representative Barbara Lee being left out on a long, tenuous limb as she complained about the proposed invasion of Iraq. It was in fear of the consequences. It was in fear of the consequences of speaking his truth openly that led W. Mark Felt to assume the mysterious persona of Deep Throat. President Kennedy's minions hid in the eye of hurricane groupthink while we the people approached the brink of nuclear disaster in the Bay of Pigs. And I might say of that triad, the one who stands out is Congresswoman Woman Barbara Lee, because she didn't hide her identity. She didn't have to go the route of Mark Felt and become Deep Throat. She didn't group herself together as one of Kennedy's yes men or yes women. No, she stood out, and it's that kind of courage that I am glad to see being taught here in the city of Oakland and the near environs. It is our privilege, folk, to have the opportunity to challenge this status quo. We don't have to settle for less when we know what is possible. But the change can only be realized if all of us heed the call to action. All of us have to be involved in it. All of us. Now, there's one other thing I want to share with you from this book. And by the way, this is not a ploy to get you to run out and buy this book. But it's okay if you do. The alarm call today is for action of the highest caliber. The wake-up alarm has sounded. We can create systems of education for all children. We can develop a healthcare system that leaves no one uncovered, but we can only do these things if all will cooperate. When President Obama sounds his own clarion call for citizen involvement, get involved. When the demand is there for expertise, offer it. If you don't feel prepared for any of this, tool up. And if by dint of circumstance and lack of opportunity you find yourself unable to contribute anything of substance, know in advance that your moral support for those who are more able is substantive to the extreme. That's the message. We all have something to offer. And even if you feel you have little to offer, by supporting those who seem to be more able, that is needed too. Nobody can do it alone. None of us can do it alone. I was talking with the students today and pontificating about this whole notion of doing it yourself. You see, because in this country, we often get a really heavy dose of individualism. You can do it yourself. You cannot. Some years ago in a university class, I challenged a group of students who were seemingly very smug. I decided to shake them up. I pointed a finger at them. And I said, all of you are on welfare. And they recoiled, and as I knew they would, because I could see the images in their heads of welfare queens, and they weren't in that bunch. I said, oh, yeah, you're on welfare. What are you talking about? I said, well, you're going here to UCLA, and at that time, the tuition was very low. I said, how much tuition do you pay? And they paid $464 per quarter. And they were proud of it. We pay our way. Until I said to them, who pays the rest? And they looked at me, what do you mean, who pays the rest? They were honestly unaware of the fact that tuition for students, even at that time, was around $24,000 per year per student. They were paying $464 per quarter. Who paid the rest? I had to tell them it was taxpayers. They were a bit shocked, But then they regrouped. Oh, yes, but we are taxpayers. Oh, really? How much tax do you pay? One student volunteered. After computing how much he paid in federal and state tax, he gave me a number. And I said, young man, to be utterly fair with you, I'm going to multiply what you say you pay by a factor of 10, which I did. I put that number on the board. And I said, now, you're a do-it-yourselfer. You're at home. You've got to get to UCLA. In order to get there, you're going to have to drive your car using freeway. We're going to figure out how much freeway you can afford. So we use his tax payment, and using that as a base figure, given the cost of labor and concrete and rebar, he could afford 15 feet of freeway. And so I said to him and the rest of them, who pays for the rest of the freeway? And at that point, lights came on, because it took all of that to get them to know, you're not in this by yourself. This is a joint enterprise. So no matter what anybody says about anything, the fight to find a way to balance this equation of social equality is pertinent, important, necessary, and we need you in the fight. Thank you very much.
So long. I've been in the storm so long, but I try to make heaven my home.